Secondly, I would argue that we need to build on the strengths, that yes, our overall rankings may not be what we want them to be, but there are a lot of things that we are doing in higher ed that are right and that are good and that we need to build on. And in some ways, part of what we may need to do here is to make lemonade out of lemons. I mean, one of the criticisms that has been levied against higher ed in this state for a long, long, long time is that not enough money is being spent on higher ed, and that, as Reed says, that you know the state is just kind of too cheap to really value education. Well, 5 or 10 or 15 years ago, that sort of argument may have resonated in a way that I'm not sure it would today. I'm not here to suggest that higher ed wouldn't benefit from more funding, or that it would, or that it needs every dime that it has now. I'm not interested in a discussion right now about funding. What I am interested in is this: is to point out that in the current climate, there are a growing number of people, in view of the economic downturn, who are questioning for the first time in my lifetime whether there is value in getting a college education, and whether the enormous debt that a lot of students incur to go to college is worth it. And in that climate, a state that is able to provide education more affordably than others, it seems to me, should have a competitive advantage over other states. And I think that there would be great wisdom for us in thinking about what sort of strategy to employ for raising our standing in the eyes of people in higher education, to seek to be at the very top of all of those rankings of schools offering the best value. Because those sorts of rankings, I think, in the next 10, 15 years are going to become increasingly important to consumers who have historically thought any amount of money for college education is going to pay off. The better the school, the better the investment. I think many people are increasingly now about to say, whoa, I got to be sure that the dollars I'm putting in are going to pay off. I want good quality education at an affordable price. I think Florida is better positioned to offer that than just about any other state I can think of. We ought to use that to our advantage. I think we also ought to continue to, and this is sometimes controversial, in fact, Reed, he argued that our system of financial aid is upside down, that Bright Futures is rewarding students that are in a position to be able to afford higher education, that more monies ought to be given to poorer kids. Our organization has a different take on that. We believe that there is wisdom in seeking to keep the very best students in this state, Bright Futures, I think, has proved to do that, just as the Hope Scholarship in Georgia has had that same sort of effect there. And we think that there is merit in continuing to link Bright Futures to merit, to see, because in many ways, part of the problem with higher education today, I would argue, is that there are some students who are being encouraged to go to college who probably ought not be in college. But those students who have distinguished themselves in the classroom and about whom we all ought to have great confidence that they are apt to succeed in college, in my mind, are a better bet. And it makes sense to me for Bright Futures dollars to be flowing in the same way that they have to students of merit. Obviously, we need to continue to build off of existing programs at various schools that are excellent and build up their reputations there. And I would count myself among those who would say that the emphasis, the increasing emphasis on STEM programs is a wise emphasis, that we can and should do more to seek to attract programs and people in those fields. I do not, however, want to see that come at the expense of liberal arts education. I don't view this as an either-or sort of a choice. And I would argue, certainly anyone from the James Madison Institute ought to argue, that part of the purpose of higher education isn't simply to prepare people for jobs, but to help provide a more informed, engaged, educated citizenry, to exercise our responsibilities as citizens, and that some of those programs, liberal arts programs, that others might say, I'm not sure I know the career value of this, do have important parts to play in becoming better informed citizens. And indeed, you'll find people in Silicon Valley and elsewhere who will argue that some of those critical thinking and creative skills that are often learned in those sorts of classes carry over and make a significant difference in some of the more technological fields as well. So it's not an either-or choice between STEM and liberal arts, but I do think that there is wisdom in giving emphasis to STEM in a way that perhaps hasn't happened to this point. All right, lastly, on the question of higher education, I would argue here again, as with K-12, that we need to be in a position to innovate and to take advantage of new technologies and to question increasingly some of the models that have been given to us in terms of how we structure school, how we structure the school calendar. I think digital education has great potential, not just in K-12, but at the higher ed level. I'm really intrigued by this Full Sail University down here in the Orlando area, which has moved, much like the Florida Virtual School, to a system where you can enter classes at almost any time of the year. It doesn't follow the kind of agrarian calendar that we typically see in both K-12 and higher ed. And so you're better able to kind of finish a degree more quickly, which I think is going to have appeal again as people begin to count the cost of some of these sorts of investments. And I think that because so much of what Full Sail offers, it offers both classes in the classroom as well as whole tracks that are digital, there is I think, potential to a lot of that. I think there is also wisdom in tinkering with Bright Futures in some creative ways. And I suspect many of you who are from Gainesville probably experience this much like we do in Tallahassee. But I've been a part of some local groups in Tallahassee looking at economic development. And one of the big things that is talked about a lot there is how can we reverse the brain drain, where we get all these college students who come to Tallahassee, they study, they learn, and then as soon as they get their degree, they leave town. And we don't keep them to help our city grow and prosper. And one of the things that I've kind of observed as I've kind of looked at certain patterns is that while we are losing an awful lot of college students that we might like, that have come from other places, that we might in a perfect world like to keep, there are an awful lot of kids who grow up in Tallahassee, go to high school there, and then end up going off to college somewhere else, who eventually come back and plant roots there among their extended family and all the rest. And I suspect that probably happens a fair amount in Gainesville. And there's a part of me in looking at Bright Futures that says, maybe we ought, in addition to offering the options that we currently do for undergraduate education, maybe we ought to also have a track or option available that if a student wants to go away somewhere else, out of state, for their undergraduate experience, but wants to, in a certain sense, be a boomerang, you know, and come back and do their graduate study here, that we might have some monies available to them for that. Because my hunch is that where you spend those graduate school years is perhaps a better predictor of where you might eventually settle or what sort of opportunities you might want to take advantage of or what sorts of creative spin-off companies you might want to start or things of that nature. And so there may be wisdom in looking at that as a potential option in addition to the existing things that we're doing. We've started something kind of like this with Bright Futures just this past year, where students who finished their four-year undergrad in less than 4 years are given the option of taking a free graduate semester. And so there is a precedent for doing something in the graduate realm. There may be wisdom in exploring ways to do beyond that. There may also be wisdom in our taking advantage of the kind of unique attractiveness of Florida to partner with elite institutions in other parts of the country and perhaps even the world in the same way that I see routinely in Europe. Where you see programs like, for example, my daughter, after she finished at USC, she went and studied at Oxford, a Shakespeare program there that was taught by some professors from Yale. And there, she was like many other students who are encouraged to go and study abroad and spend a summer in Europe or something of that sort. I look at Florida and I say, this is a pretty nice place to be in January, where a lot of schools have January terms that are in cold weather locations that could just as easily, in a partnership here, set up shop here, or perhaps even in May, during that May master term that some schools have. There may be the potential for us to partner with some other schools or other programs or develop some of our own that might use the unique attractiveness of Florida as a drawing card in the same way that a lot of programs in Europe do the same sort of thing with students. Well, those are a variety of things that we can consider doing that might help us to innovate in the way of higher education, but I think the key is going to be for us to develop some sort of comprehensive strategy that helps us to begin to think more like a conference instead of like a particular team, and seeks to work together to build a better higher education system generally. The hope, of course, in all of this, as we seek to improve and continue the progress that's been made on K through 12, and as we seek to build on the existing strengths and the unique opportunities that exist in higher ed, the hope in all of this is that we would be able to develop a better workforce for the future that is capable of doing more than just the kind of primary industries that we've or areas of occupation that we've had in years past, that we would be able to draw people who have the discretion to live seemingly anywhere, increasingly to our state, recognizing that education is a magnet, and that it will become increasingly so if as more and more schools move away from a kind of factory model of education, and as more and more education takes place anytime, anywhere, at any pace, rather than following the agrarian calendar that we've had for many years. Florida, I think, is uniquely positioned to take advantage of some of these changes, and while there are problems and areas that we need to address, I personally am optimistic about the future. I think we can and should and will make a lot of these sorts of changes and be in a better position to crow about not just our K through 12 schools, but our unique higher ed success in a very short period of time.